Sorry.
Spark.
No.
Yeah.
No.
Good morning, Church.
Good
morning, everyone, my brothers and sisters in Christ. How wonderful to be in the house of the Lord again.
Amen.
On Sunday morning, that even if it is hot, you are here to glorify our Father in heaven. Lord, we pray, Father God, that we start our day with a grateful heart, O Father. Lord, thank you, O Father, for all the blessings, O Father God. Thank you that you brought us all here, O Father God, safe, bound by your love, O Father. Lord, as we start our worship and praises today, we will sing aloud, O Father God. We will sing for joy, O Lord, for you have given us glorious things, greatness, O Father God, in our lives, O Lord. Bless, Lord, the word, the songs that we're going to sing, that it will lift your name for your glory and for your honor, O Father God. And as we listen to the service to the Lord, your message, O Father God, let the word help us, O Father, lift your word, the word that is active, the word that is alive, the word that is sharper, O Father God, than any double-edged sword, O Father God, that it will help us draw ourselves closer to you, Lord, O Father, bearing, Lord, good works in the knowledge of you. Lord, we thank you, Lord, for all the blessings, O Father God. You may be praised, you may be glorified, O Father God. And we pray, Lord, that we will follow you. We will pursue your humbleness, your goodness, O Father God, and your holiness, O Father, that we're going from glory to glory to glory. In Jesus' name I pray.
Amen. 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 Amen.
All of my days.
You're the God of all my days. To the Thank you. Well, good morning, everyone.
Morning.
You of us are awake. Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
It's good to be in the house of the Lord. Amen.
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 How many of you are happy?
Amen.
How many of you have the joy of the Lord?
Amen.
Despite the world or what we live in or what we're dealing with, God is always there. Do you believe that?
Amen.
He is the one that can only restore our broken hearts. A lot of us walk around wounded. A lot of us walking around struggling each and every day, but despite the struggles, despite our wounds, the trials, the tribulations, and all that, God is good. And that's why we're here, is to rejoice and to give God praise. Amen?
Amen.
Praise God. Welcome to Consecrated Bible Church, HCBC. It's always a privilege and an honor to stand before you because we are here in the house of the Lord.
Amen.
Hopefully you're excited about being here. If you woke out of bed, that's a blessing. If you took your first breath of the day, that came from God. Amen? And you should always rejoice in that. So hopefully all of us are doing well, happy to be here, and eager to hear the Word of God.
Amen.
Amen.
Only a few. Eager to hear the Word of God. Amen?
Amen.
Okay, I'm trying to get you excited, trying to get you upbeat and forget about your whatever is going on outside. What you have to do in 2 hours from now, because I'm going to preach for 2 hours straight.
Amen.
Amen.
All right.
Amen.
Okay. In a year of uncertainty, in a year where we are unstable, so to speak, in what is happening, is COVID going up or going down? And we kind of judge our temperament on what is going on in the world today. Am I going to be a happy person? Is inflation going to dictate how I live? Are the gas prices that go up going to be sad or be angry? No. Despite what happens, God is still faithful. Amen? And so with that, I want to tell you that Jesus is our living hope. Jesus is our living hope. And with Him, He is the one that can answer all our problems. He's the one that we put our hope into. And not a man. Don't put your hope into the person sitting next to you. Because that person, sooner or later, will disappoint you. Right, spouses? Amen, right? Okay. So I want you to turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 4 to 6. And we've been studying the stewardship of time, treasures, and talent. Today we're going to be talking about talent. And so with that, turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 4 to 6. If you have your Bibles, say amen.
Amen.
1 Corinthians chapter 12, if you haven't there, just turn to that. And we're going to read. There's a different kind of gift, but the same Spirit. Verse 5. There's a different kind of service, but the same Lord. There are different kinds of workings, but the same God works in all of them, in all men. And so with that, we see that there are different kinds of talents. We have, how many people here? 40, 50 people? Each one of us is unique. We're not robots in a robotic world, okay? You see where everything is being done by a robot. Sister Nora and I went down to Proms over here on Central. They have a little robot that delivers your food to you. It's cute, but kind of scary, right? But see, you see that, and it does not have a mind. It just tells us what to do. God gave us the freedom of choice. He told us, He gave us the free choice of following Him or not submitting to him. That's our free will. That's a choice that he gives us. And that's what we have today. You have the free will. Different kinds of spiritual gifts, the same spirit. This is a service that we all have, okay? Different kinds. We have different talents in this room, believe it or not. Some are good in one aspect and others are weak in something else. Some are mechanically inclined, others don't even know what a hammer is. Or what end do you use? Or a screwdriver. Give me a Phillips or a flathead and say, what's that? You know? And some people don't know that, but other people can cook a great meal and other people cannot. And so you see things like that. Each one of us has a talent. Now, what is your godly given talent? That's for you to find out. What talent can I use for God? And how do I use that? And how do I move ahead? What kind of vision do you have? Back in July 20th, 1969, how many of you born before 1969? Raise your hand. A few of us, right? And so what is that? Okay, back in when John F. Kennedy was president, he says he's going to put a man in the moon. And by the end of the decade. And so that was a vision. That was a dream of his. Despite his death on November 22nd, 1963, he died. But his vision continued. And with his vision, man did the impossible. From Nassau, from the lowest to the highest to the smartest person, we were able to put a man on the moon. Amen? And so that was a big accomplishment. And you'll never forget where you were during that time if you're alive. You remember where you were, maybe in front of a black and white TV, and you heard, who was the first astronaut to land on the moon? What was his name? Neil Armstrong? His first step on the moon. And so those are things that we look for. Those are things that we are looking at. Let me get a bottle of water. Thank you. We see that happening, and we see that as we go through our life. Life is a journey, amen? And with life's journey, it's impossible to know what lies ahead. Only person that knows what lies ahead is who? God. And he has our days numbered. He knows what we're going to be doing tomorrow, next week. And he knows the beginning and the end of our life. There is something that you are gifted in, talented in. What is your passion? Ask yourself, what is your passion? And you put a blank there, because I don't know where your passion is. Ask yourself, what is your passion? What do you like to do? Fill in that blank. Well, doesn't have to be spiritual. What do you like to do? I like sports. I like to work on cars. I like to cook. I like to pray. I like to bake. I like to outside. I like to plant a garden. I like to study. I like to read the Word. All of those are talents given by God. You believe that?
Amen.
I'm just living Bible. God gave you a life to live for a purpose, and that purpose is to live with Him. Some of us like sports, singing. Some like speaking and teaching and nurturing. Some like playing with little children, right? And raising kids, being with grandkids, and building things. And all those things have our talents. Can God use those talents in the church?
Amen.
Yes, He can. And He wants you to use your talent, whatever it is. Only you know what it is. You know, 80% of the work in the church is done by 20% of the people. And sometimes it's 90% of the work is done by 10% of the people. And so where are the other 80 or 90%? What are they doing? And so these gifts can be used for the glory of God to advance the kingdom of God. In James chapter 1, verse 17, it says, every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of heavenly lights, who does not change like the shifting shadow. God is standard. He is real. He's the same yesterday, today, and forever. God does not change. And yet, He has given us every perfect gift to us. Every gift comes from God. Your life, your breath comes from God. This verse tells us that every gift, every talent you have is from God. And we have different talents, which are important and can be used for the kingdom of God. You have to remember that. I keep repeating that. You have to remember each gift is from God. In 1 Corinthians, the Apostle Paul compares the individuals to the body of Christ to do different parts of the body. You know, all of us take your body. You have hands, you have feet, you have ears, you have nose, you have all those things put together. You have a heart, you have a kidney, you have a stomach, you have lungs. Each and every part of your body is important. Amen. Right? Amen. You cannot think without a brain. You cannot pump blood without a heart. You cannot think of things without a hand. You can't walk without feet. Every part of the body is important. Which is greater, your heart or your brain? Well, both are important. How about your eyesight? Well, I can see where I'm going. See, this is the body of Christ. This is the church. The church is not the building with people in it. And you have to understand the people in it. What are you doing for God? Even though each part serves a different purpose, it is needed. In the church, everybody here, every part is needed to have a healthy church. For the church to function properly and be efficient, each and every one of you are important. You have God-given talents. You know, the moment you walk into this building, you are a blessing. Whether you know it or not, whether you believe it or not, you are a blessing.
Amen.
Tell the person next to you, you are a blessing.
You are a blessing.
Amen. In 1 Peter 4, 10 through 11, this is very important for us to listen. 1 Peter, listen to this. 1 Peter 4, 10 and 11, it says, each one should use whatever gift he has received to serve others, faithfully administering God's grace in its various forms. Now, let's keep it there and we'll go back to verse 10. It says, each one, who's that? Me, each one of you should use whatever gift God has given you. I want to be like Pastor Art. I want his gift. That's not yours. God chose. He was called to be a pastor. His gift is different than your gift. Is his more important? No. All of us are important. Pastor Art would be a great preacher, but to an empty congregation, what happens? Nothing. I could be here preaching in front of everybody to an empty house or empty room. What happens? Who's going to hear? See, all of us are an important part of the body of Christ. When you walk in, it says, praise God. That's what you should be saying, praise the Lord. And you shouldn't be looking at, oh, I don't want this at the end of the day. Oh, she's coming to the church? Oh, no, not in that room. No, you should not be like that. You should have a loving heart, a forgiving heart, a heart of reconciliation if you have a problem. Our relationships should be pure, deep, and real with one another. Amen?
Amen?
There's only one body of Christ, and that's all of us in here. Amen?
Amen.
Give God the glory. Give him the hand clap. Believe it. Okay? So, each one of us should do whatever gift you have. Verse 17, we'll go there. Verse 11, I'm sorry. If anyone speaks, he should do it as one speaking the very words of God. Wow. So when you speak, don't speak as me, myself, and I, but speak as God is speaking. God, the Holy Spirit, using you to speak his words. And I pray that God will use his words to come through me. I'm just the vessel. I'm just the conduit. I'm just the pipeline to speak to each and every one of you. If anyone serves, he should do it with the strength of God, the strength God provides, so that in all God may be praised through Jesus Christ. We're not here to glorify ourselves. We're not here to for acknowledgement and say, look, I'm more righteous than anybody here. No, that is not what is the purpose is. The purpose is not to glorify self, but to glorify God. Amen?
Amen.
To him be the glory and the power forever and ever. Amen. Praise God. God gets the glory forever and ever. You are a good vessel. You know, when somebody has high cholesterol, what happens? Are the arteries plugged up and you can't get blood flowing? What happens? You end up having a heart attack or a stroke. We have to have clean vessels. We have to be a clean vessel where we just portray Jesus Christ. There's not a little bit of you mixed with God. It's God all the way. Amen? Are you speaking the words of God? This is what he wants us to do. Speak the very words of God. Well, how do I know that? Read the word of God. Are you daily reading the word of God? That is very important for us to do. If anyone serve, they should do it with the strength of God that God provides. I'm so tired, Pastor, and burnt out. Are you relying on your own strength, or are you relying on the strength of God? You know, you work, and say, well, where's the evidence? God is giving you the strength to continue, right? Father, time is chasing you, trying to catch up. Don't stop. Keep going, right? That's what keeps you young. You want to live to 100? Keep going. Don't stop. Keep going. So that in all things, God may be praised through Jesus Christ. To him be the glory and the power forever and ever. Right? And so with that, you're praising God. Is God going to destroy you? No. He's going to bless you. Right? He's going to give you more and more of his likeness. Here the Bible compares believers like me and you to being faithful stewards. Are you a faithful steward? Stewardship. We talked about time. We talked about treasures. Now we're talking about your talents, right? And with a faithful steward, you can have all the talent in the world, but it's a change of heart. It's what is in your heart. And so you have desire. I want to serve God. I could go into the secular field and make all kinds of money with my talent. I could be a businessman. I could make thousands and thousands, millions and millions of dollars, but I submit to God. And now I'm using all my talents and gifts for the purpose of what? Building the kingdom of God. Amen? You want to do that in your life? Well, I don't have millions. We need to have Jesus. And you can use whatever talent. Just a smile to your neighbor. Just a kind word of encouragement to a friend, a co-worker. Even your spouse. Honey, I love you. Thank you for being my wife. Honey, thank you. You're the best husband that has ever been.
Amen.
Man, how would you like to hear that?
Amen.
Women, you want your husband.
You love
you say
love.
Kind words.
You love him.
And not
love.
Take you for granted. They say, oh, honey, that was the best meal I ever had.
Amen.
You know? And so it's just the kind words can go a long way, you know. But we're short tempered. We take things for granted, and we fail to do things that God wants us to do. So the word that we speak should be the very words of what? Of God. Are you a faithful steward? Are you doing what he wants? Are you utilizing your talents for God? For God's will, you find purpose in your life. Is the opportunity to share God's love there for you? Are you sharing the word of God to others? Are you bringing others to Christ? Are you talking and speaking words of encouragement when somebody's down? Are you praying for people? All that comes from God. Every single one of us can do that. Oh, Father, but Pastor, I'm so shy. I'm so timid. I don't like to speak. God says, I'll give you the strength. I'll give you the opportunity to do that. Just a simple word to say, hi, welcome, thank you. You're such a nice person. Kind words will lead to what? A relationship. And you can share the gospel. In a healthy church, you will find faithful stewards. Both with time, treasure, and talent. That is a mark of a healthy church. Amen?
Amen.
Give God a big hand. That's what it is. The healthy church will find faithful stewards time, treasure, and talent. Well, two out of three might isn't too bad. See, God doesn't want 66% of you. He wants 100%. He wants 110%. When somebody's running 100-yard dash, 100 meters, here's the finish line, he just doesn't stop. Walk across. What did he do? He continues at least 10 more yards. Pass. He doesn't let up on his speed. He continues, takes off, and he passes the finish line. It's to the end. God doesn't want you halfway. He wants you to be committed 100%. Being faithful is being dependable. Are you dependable to God?
Amen.
Are you here one Sunday and not the next? Are you a Sunday Christian? You only come when it's convenient. You sacrifice. Oh, nobody likes the word sacrifice. Absolutely, you don't know my day. I got so much planned in my life. I don't have time to go to church today. I don't have time to listen to the Bible study. I don't have time to come here, whatever activity. I got so many things, just stop. Listen to what you're saying. In other words, you don't have time for God. Because God wants action. He doesn't want you just to be praying for you. He wants you to be doing something. Oh, Father God, help me be a better servant of you. Okay, here's the opportunity right here. Who wants to be a better servant? Just a few. More and more. Keep raising your hand. Everybody raise
Amen.
Your hand.
Amen.
More. Everybody raise your hand. Who wants to be a... If you don't raise your hand, then I'm going to pray for you and you do. Right? All of us want to be a better servant for God.
Amen.
But I don't know what my talent is. What's your desire in your heart? What do you want? Your talent will be beneficial to the kingdom of God.
Amen.
I hope that you realize that we all can make a difference in the world. Can you make a difference in the world? Yes, right? Amen.
Amen.
Can you make a difference in the world? Amen. We can, right?
Amen.
All of us can make a difference. Well, where does it start? It starts with you.
Amen.
It starts in the heart.
Amen.
It starts, I'm going to be make a difference in my life. I need Jesus more than ever. During these times of trouble and hurl and all that, you know, the storms and everything we look at, you know, bombarded with on TV, we really need Jesus.
Amen.
He's the hope of the world. But it starts with me. It starts with a change of attitude. It starts with a change of heart. It starts with you. And then you make a difference to your spouse, your sons and daughters, your aunts and uncles, to everyone around you. And now it's a ripple effect because now you are an example to everyone you meet. And the desire for you is greater and greater. Oh, God is blessing me because of what I'm doing. I'm not doing it just because I do it because I love Jesus. But He'll give you the blessing and more blessings. And He'll give you the love. And now you are what? Lavishing with God's love. The love of Jesus is not by the gallon. Sometimes we go and fill up our cars and, you know, a gallon of gas is almost $6-$7 a gallon. I said, man, that's not going to get me very far. When you go to Jesus for a gallon of love, He gives you a full tank.
Amen.
And it's free. What's more important, gasoline or the love of Jesus? Well, the gasoline can make you go. The love of Jesus never runs out.
Amen.
It continues mile after mile, week after week, month after month, year after year, and it continues and continues and continues.
Amen.
Longer than that bunny you see that never ever generates, right? Longer than that. To God is constant. He does not change. And so, we have been entrusted by God with gifts, talents to be used to glorify Him. There's a parable in Matthew 25, 14 to 25, 14 to 25. And here we have a master who was going away. Jesus spoke in parables. And maybe you heard this before. And what it is it talents of the parable of talents of Jesus died. It's found in Matthew 25, 14 to 25. Here we have the master who's going away and called his servants and entrusted him with his property. One servant was given 5 talents. The other was given 2 talents. One was given 1 talent, each according to their ability. And so the man left on his trip. And then he was gone for a while. And so what happened? What we see was the one with 5 talents, he invested and gained another 5. And then the same thing with the one with 2 talents, he gained 2 more. But the one that had 1 talent, he was lazy and did nothing. He just buried the 1 talent that God had given him. After a period of time, the man returns, the master returns, and he goes and to account for what happened. The one with 5 talents brought another 5. The master being proud of me with 5 and I have gained another 5. Was the master pleased? Great God, he was. The master replied, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful with a few, and I will put you in charge of many things. Come and share the master's happiness." Then the man with 2 talents also came, "Master, he had entrusted thee with 2 talents, and I have gained 2 more. Well done, well said. The master said, "Well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful in a few things, and I will put you in charge of many. Come and share in your master's happiness." Now comes to the one with 1 talent. I'm going to read Matthew 25, and it's not very good. It's very disappointing. Then the man who had received 1 talent came, "Master," he said, "I knew that you were a hard man, harvesting where you have not sown and gathered where you have not scattered seed. So I was afraid and went out and hid your talent in the ground. Here, this is what belongs to you." His master replied, "You wicked and lazy servant. So you knew that I harvest where I have not sown and gather where I have not scattered seed. Well then, you should have put my money on deposit with the banker so that when I return, I would have received it back with interest. Take the talent from him, give it to one who has 10 talents. For everyone will be given more, and he will have abundance. Whoever does not have even what he has been taken from, and throw that worthless servant outside in darkness, where there will be much weeping and gnashing of teeth." Very harsh. What does that mean? God has given us all talents. Is your investment in God's kingdom? Jesus coming back. What do you have to show for your talents? It's a hard question to answer if you're not utilizing your talents. God wants us to use the talents that He gave us. And the talents are not being used. Imagine going to heaven and if you get there. And your talents are there, just like your blessings, never called upon. And they say, "Here, this is all your, these are all the blessings of God that were not utilized. Here's all the talents you could have had, but you failed to use them." God wants to use our talents, and He gave each and every one of us talents. He expects us to use these talents to multiply the kingdom, to edify our brothers and sisters. In other words, to bless each and every one of us, to build us up, right? And to grow in the maturity of Christ. Are you growing in the maturity of Christ? Are you the same person you were last year? Or 5 years ago? Or 10 years? Are you still struggling spiritually? God has not left us. We are not helpless here on earth. He gave us our talents to what? To carry out the Great Commission. Matthew 28:19. Going out and making disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Are you doing that? Are you going out making disciples of all nations, of all people? Not just certain people, but all people. Are you doing that for God? And sometimes, sadly, we are not. We come as a social club, coming together and leaving happy and forgetting what God has promised for us. We have to be careful not to ignore the calling of God.
Amen.
There's a lady named Martha Berry. She had a vision to help kids. She began a school for four children. She had no books, no building, no money, only a vision. Well, this lady is crazy. She wants to build a school. How can you have a school with no money, no books? Some kids don't like that. There's no books in our school. Amen. Praise God. Right? No. You need books to learn. No building, no money. Only a vision, only a dream. So she went to Henry Ford, the one that began Ford Motor Company. We know Henry Ford. How many of you drive a Ford? Found on the road dead. Right? That's just a thing, okay. Anyway, so he went to Henry Ford to ask for a donation. Mr. Ford reached into his pocket and gave Martha one dime. 10 cents. Most people would be insulted for a multi-billionaire to receive a dime. And that's all he could give, the dime. But Martha took that dime, bought a packet of seeds, planted a garden, raised a crop, sold it, bought more seeds. And after 3 or 4 harvests, she had enough money to purchase an old building for the school.
Amen.
Amen, right? We got the building. So she returned to Mr. Ford and told him, see what your 10 cents had done. Being so impressed that he donated $1 million to her school.
Amen.
$1 million back in the day, that's a lot of money. He donated $1 million. Maybe you have a vision and you think you don't have the resources. You don't have the books. You don't have the building. You don't have the money. Only a vision. Who's greater, Mr. Ford, who's dead, or our living Lord Jesus Christ?
Amen.
Where do you go?
Amen.
You go to Christ. For the Jesus, and he will supply all your needs. He might give you a little bit. Oh, that's not enough. What do you expect me to do with this, Lord? They can't even pay the rent. They can't even make a down payment on my car. My vision is big. A vision, a dream, has to have a heart's desire.
Amen.
To do more.
Amen.
You make whatever you have, give it to God, and he will multiply it. Amen?
Amen.
He will multiply it. And so, who's our greatest supplier? Jesus. He supplies everything that we have, the need, right? Everything. Our resources. Can anyone outgive God?
No.
People try, but they have restrictions. They have limits, right? I'll do this if you give me 20% of that. How many of you watch Shark Tank? You seen that? Okay, I'll give you $100,000. Instead of 10%, I'll give you 20% of what you make. And the deal's done. God says, here it is. Go do your vision. If it's go and do that, right? If it's within the will of God, he will make it happen. You will be blessed beyond what is happening. All of us have skills and talents. All all of us need. What we need to utilize them for God. What is your talent? Some are content with the status quo, with what we have. Past are good. I just want to sit here and just listen to the word of God and pray and stuff. And then go home and watch Netflix. Go home and watch or you like to watch the Dodgers like I do and watch it from the beginning to the end. Okay? Or listen to music, whatever you like to do. It's my time. Okay? But God wants your time to be His time.
Amen.
How much time are you putting into God? What God needs, listen to this. It's not going to be a shock what I say, but God, what God needs are workers. Are you a worker for God? Nobody likes that evil four-letter word, work. W-O-R-K. That's a bad word for many of us. I'm retired. I don't work anymore. I'm too old. You're never too old to work for Christ.
Amen.
24 hours a day, 7 days a week, but I get tired. No, you don't. God will give you the strength. You're never going to get burned out. Right, Pastor Art? We never get burned out.
Amen.
Continue. God bless you. Continue. Right? Not just on Sunday morning, coming here and being content. God does not like content people. He doesn't like to be stagnant. Because when we're stagnant, we're not moving, we begin to smell. When you have stagnant water that's not moving, what happens? It begins to stink. And women, moms out there, and ladies, if you ever receive the bouquet of flowers, the roses are so beautiful, and your husband sent it so nice, and then after 2 weeks, what happens? It begins to smell. See, the rose is not alive anymore, it's dead. It's just preserved in the water for a few days. After 2 weeks, what happens? You go, it doesn't smell very good. Because it's not alive. See, when and it stinks, you have to do what? Throw it out. But for us, when we are attached to the living hope, Jesus Christ, living, not dead, what happens? We praise and we worship a resurrected God.
Amen.
His name is Jesus. When we worship Him, He gives us new life. We'll hook on to Him. He lives in our heart. The Holy Spirit gives us the power to move forward.
Amen.
Amen. And now, I said, I don't know where I'm going, but this is like a ride in Disneyland, right? Never been on a roller coaster going up, up and up. And then, okay, here it comes. And boom, you're on your way. I'm not saying that going to Jesus is like a roller coaster ride, but it's a thrill.
Amen.
You thrill to serve God.
Amen.
He said, man, what's going to happen tomorrow? And you're blessed. You can't, you're excited about what's going to happen tomorrow and the next day. Or you're just dreading, man, I have to go to work tomorrow. There's so much on my plate. So much I have to do. Not life. You know, you give that to God.
Amen.
I said, you know what? My work is going to be dedicated to God, not to my boss.
Amen.
He's so mean. Expects too much. God says, I'll give you the strength. Just stay positive. And you keep moving. And you're going to be joyful. You're going to be smiling, not complaining. We all fall short of the glory of God. God made it possible for us to be involved. He wants us to be involved, not isolated. See, the problem with church today, we're hooked on Facebook Live, and we're hooked on Zoom. And when we do that, we feel comfortable. I don't have to get dressed for church. I can watch Pastor Art myself or whoever's teaching in my pajamas. What a sight. I want to tell you something. It's important for you to come to church and have fellowship with others. because there is no Zoom in heaven. You're not going to be here watching heaven via Zoom or Facebook Live. It doesn't exist. You have to. You're going to be with Him in the present. Yes, we have to be careful with the COVID and all that. Yes, it's convenient. And it helps us to save gas and all that. But don't make that your lifestyle. Make being in church a lifestyle. Helping and utilizing the gifts that we have. We all fall short of the glory of God. That's why we have Jesus. We think we're good enough, but we lack confidence on being saved and living in victory. God has given us a unique abilities, talents, and gifts, and they represent who we are. Shape our spiritual gifts, our heart, abilities, personality, experience. Shape. Spiritual gifts, heart, abilities, personality, and experience. What shape are you in? I'm going to talk about myself because I know myself better than you. And this is kind of personal. But never in my life would I ever think of standing here before you. I grew up in this area here. I went to a local church here, and I found out it's a different church now. And the other day we walked by, and it's, I forget what the church name is. But I went by there and it's an old different church. I told Sister Nana, I told my wife, that used to be my church. And praise God, it still existed. But anyway, I grew up as not a Roman Catholic, but as a Christian. From the time I was born to the time I'm here today. I've seen it all. I've seen churches grow. I've seen churches divide. I've been in big churches and small churches. And so, I began teaching because there was no one available. And I taught because I read the Bible. I knew the Bible, right? But did I really practice what I read, you know? I was going to say preach, but I wasn't a preacher. Long story short, I continued, and then came the opportunity of being a Bible study teacher. I began teaching Bible studies from 2005 all the way to 2012. Every Saturday, every week, if there was something going on Saturday, we would have it either on Friday or Thursday. But we never missed. And we met every week. From our house, Moreno Valley, to Chino, everywhere we went. And we would have people come. Pastor Art remembers, he came in and he taught on Sunday. Sunday. We had 40 people in our Bible study. And sometimes more, depending if it was a pateau fight, right? Everybody came because afterwards, we would all have our potluck and watch the fight. Sometimes we had 60 people there. But what I'm trying to tell you is that we're utilizing what God has given me. I'm not bragging or anything like that, but I felt a calling. And people say, you've got to become a pastor. I said, no way, I'm not going to be a pastor. I'm just teaching. I'm not qualified yet. Right? I didn't say, yeah, I'm not qualified to do that. See, never say you're not qualified. If that's a desire. So what happened, I kind of resisted that until 2013. I felt the call of God. I'm almost breaking down in tears right now, but you felt that call.
Amen.
And it's still there. I said, Lord, if this is what you want, confirm it with the Word of God. And confirmation, be from the Word. Prayer, confirmation. Prayer, confirmation. It's not just something you say, I'm going to be a pastor, we're going to have our first Bible church service here. That is not how you begin a church. That's what it's failing. Okay? It has to be a calling. It has to be from you. And you have to have a supportive wife.
Amen.
A supportive person with you if you're married, right? You have to set somebody to what? Lift you up and be there for you. And together, you are looking not at each other, but looking towards God.
Amen.
And so when you start in our house. We had a big, we built a room, and called it the white room. We sat, you know, we sat 435, 40 chairs, the white chairs we have there. We put them there, and our worship was from here to there, about this wide. That's our members of our worship team. I said, wow. For 11 months we did that, right? And our church grew. Then a year later we found a building on the other side. Right? 3 years there. Moved over here. No, 4 years there. We moved over here and went on. 3 years. Went on 4 years. What I'm trying to say is that it's a calling. Utilize the talents, the very little talents of God. I'm not a preacher. I don't know how to do this. But God, if that's your calling, God will give you the words. Not my words, but His words. Right? Pastor Art was very instrumental in me preaching. He allowed me to preach at HCBC at nighttime when we started the night service. And he said, here you go. This is yours. And with that, I will forever be grateful because it gave me an opportunity. We started with a few, and we ended up with a big group at Pastor Art. On Sunday, 5 o'clock, on Roswell, 4 weeks we worked. And so that was the launch point, the starting point of me being here. But also, there's trials. And I don't want to get into what happened. But basically, what other people wanted to do was not biblical. So I said, I stand firm upon the word of God. I'm not going to say yes to what, no. What is important, they left. And you can imagine what was going on, right? Me. I wanted to give up. Sister Noah said, no, you're going to maintain, you're going to stay and stand firm. And here we are today. Amen. Pastor Art came, and this has happened right before COVID. You can imagine 2 years with a 50 church. I wanted to pay the building and all that. It's by the grace of God that we're standing here before you.
Amen.
Still survive. Pastor Art comes calling, hey, Pastor Hector, we need a building. Okay. We met, we talked. I said, I've never had two different churches in one building, one worship service. It's not that going to work. But God, everything's possible.
Amen.
All things are possible with God. And so we are already starting our food distribution. That was going like 5-6 years now, maybe 7 years been doing that. We've been supporting different missionaries, our hope for kids, and those type of things are going on. And I look back and reflect, and I look back when we started this, and wow, look where we're at. Not by what I do, but what Jesus did.
Amen.
That's what counts. Now, I'm not saying that all of you are going to have your own church, but maybe you will. Don't limit God. Don't say that's impossible. Of course it's impossible, but God wants it to happen in your life. Whether you are a worship leader playing drums, a keyboard singer, whether you are a faithful steward in your time or in your treasure, in your talents, God needs it all. Not for His sake, but saying for Him. He's not greedy. It's for our benefit. Everything we do is for our benefit. And the way that it's for our benefit, we have to bless Him. Right? He doesn't need your money. He owns the whole world. But it's for us to be giving. It's for us to give our time. It's for us to give our talents. It benefits who? It benefits us. It builds up the body of Christ. There's one thing I want to tell you before we go on and discuss. We need to change the heart. Our hearts need to be shaken. Flushed out all the purge, all the things that are not necessary. All the hurt, all the divide, all the sin, the things that are hidden in our lives need to be washed out. are you meditating on some other God or worshiping this person or that person or going to different schools and everything? It's by the resurrected power of Jesus Christ at the room of all sin.
Amen.
That's what it's about. Amen.
Amen.
I want you to come forward and worship you and come forward. And so with that, I want you to realize that all things are possible with God. Where are your talents being used? What is going on in your life? What has happened? And so if you need prayer, whether it's, I want Jesus to come into my life, I lost track, there are things that I don't feel well about my relationship with God is not healthy. I want more. I want to rededicate. Maybe I never had Christ in my life. You can do that today. Or I have a sickness, or I have a problem, or I want prayer. We ask you to come forward. Let's all stand. Whatever the need might be, God is here. God is faithful. He wants to help us.
So I'm going to ask you to come forward and step up, and I can pray for you.
You give life, you are love, you bring light to the darkness, you give hope, you restore.
You pour out a presence, it's your Her ministry there will be very powerful. She has about how many pastors do we have there? Four pastors, I think, three pastors. And they have about five outreaches now. So it's a powerful. She inherited the calling of her husband. I didn't know that it can be transferred. Because her husband was a pastor. Okay, so let's begin to pray. Let's pray for her. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you so much. The life of us is a grace, a Lord. It's an inspiration to all of us. She has dedicated her life to you, Father, until the day shall come. Father, we thank you because you made her an inspiration for all of us. Now, no matter what age you are, no matter how old you are, how young you are, how fragile you are, Father, with the heart is there to love you and to serve you, you will take care of it. We're not qualified to serve you, Father. We're all sinners that are only forgiven by the blood of our Lord Jesus Christ. But when our heart is given to you 100%, you are the one who will qualify us. Look at the apostles that you have put. They were not qualified, but Jesus Christ qualified them. And so, Father, in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, we are sending her out. We're sending her off. And thank you so much for allowing her to minister to us, to the brethren here at this church. We thank you, Lord, for her love and dedication to you. May you continue to shine upon her life every day. And may you allow her to be protected by your grace and by your mercy, especially that COVID-19 is still around. Oh God, I pray for protection. I pray for millions and thousands of angels that will surround her to protect her from the enemy of the cross, Lord. I pray that the pastors there, Pastor Jason, Pastor Jiggy, and other pastors, Lord, that they have there even INC group. May you empower them as well. Give her wisdom, Lord. Take care of her. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen.
Each and every one of us has a relationship with Him. I pray
pray, Father God, as we go out into this, outside this building, Lord, that we walk in victory, not defeat. That nothing can come against us as long as we stay focused and pursuing holiness, Father God. I pray, Lord, that the Spirit of God will give us strength, will give us the power to defeat the enemy. I pray, Father, as we go out, we represent Jesus. And God, I pray, Lord, that we examine our hearts. Let us utilize the talents that are God-given for your glory, for your kingdom, Father God. I pray, Father, as we're about to have fellowship with the food, bless the food to our bodies, Father. We thank you, Lord, for the goodness of God, for what he's done in our lives. And Lord, as we walk out, we walk out as believers, that we believe in you, Father God, that all things are possible. In Jesus' name we pray.
Amen. And this is our last worship song, and it's all sing this with our heart and soul. Amen. Here we go.